Hi, my name is Oleg, and you're listening to the fifth episode of On the Health Record. My guest today is Lauren Patrick, the president and CEO at Healthmonix, a company that's using data and analytics to improve quality of care and reduce costs for medical providers. Lauren is both passionate and knowledgeable about how technology should be built and how it can be used to drive more positive outcomes for medical practices. You can tell from speaking with her that Lauren is more than just an engineer, she's a natural-born problem solver and has built a wealth of knowledge and experience in the industry. We cover a lot in the interview, from Healthmonix as a business and current events to quality of care measures and next steps around healthcare and CMS. We'll also talk about feedback and control systems from an engineer's perspective. Subscribe to the show to stay updated and leave us a rating. Send us any questions or comments to podcast@drchrono.com. And with that out of the way, let's get on with the show. Hello, everyone, and welcome to On the Health Record, where we're talking about what healthcare and technology look like today and what it should look like tomorrow. I'm really excited to be speaking with Lauren Patrick, who is founder and CEO at Healthmonix, a company helping healthcare practices measure feedback from customers and improve quality of care scores and resulting reimbursements. Lauren, welcome to the show.
Oleg, it's great to be here and be with you today.
I'm really excited to talk, but let's set up who you are for the listener. One reason I was really excited to talk with you is I saw you studied computer engineering, and my own degree was in electrical and computer engineering, which is either twice or half as impressive, I'm not sure. But Lauren, can you tell me how you got into that?
Sure. So a long time ago in a place far, far away, my father was an electrical engineer. And so when I was looking at colleges, he suggested, because I was good in math and because he had had a very successful career developing computers as an electrical engineer, that I consider going into this new field of computer science. So I got my undergraduate degree in computer science and then moved into an engineering degree for my master's, where I actually built computers, soldered transistors together, and made it all work from the ground up.
That's awesome. I got into it I didn't really know what I was getting into when I was picking electrical and engineering. And I was always interested to hear from other people that they'd been like working on computers their whole life. You know, it was like a family thing. That was always kind of inspiring to me to hear that there were people that did it like that. So it sounds like you really loved computers.
Yes, I love the ability to create. And like I said, we were really creating from the ground up. So we were developing machine languages, and we were developing compilers and operating systems and all the things today that we so take for granted.
Right, that low-level stuff of like putting the Legos together to make that bigger picture sculpture.
Right.
So you loved computers. I think you understood them at a fundamental level. When did you get into healthcare technology?
So about 10 years ago, I had a pretty storied career developing a lot of systems for a lot of different companies, General Electric, Goodyear, banks, a lot of different companies, but really felt like it was a time when I wanted to take everything I knew and apply it to something where I could make a difference. And so I moved to Philadelphia for personal reasons and went and knocked on the door of the University of Pennsylvania, and they had a really great project that they said I could help them with in terms of looking at physicians' compliance to current standards and quality of care in the arena of diabetes. So that's kind of how I got into it.
Can you unpack that a little bit more for me? Like, what were you working on? Or just keep telling me the details a little bit.
Sure. So it was about a little over 10 years ago, and quality measurement and quality improvement were becoming the next big thing in educating doctors. We all realize that doctors have careers that span 40, sometimes 50 years, and what they learn in medical school at the beginning of their career is not always the current standard of care 10, 20, 30, 40 years later. So what we were really working on doing was taking the current standard of care and looking at how physicians were conducting their practices in comparison, and then feeding that back to physicians so that then they could work on perhaps changing their practices, improving quality of care for their patients, and learning from this whole exercise so that overall we would have better outcomes for patients.
Yeah, it's kind of an interesting problem where there's that lag you get in school between, you know, what's the industry standard and what's actually in practice right now. Another problem that I've run into on the podcast, just talking to doctors, is, you know, you're trained in medicine, but the job you have to do is so much bigger than that. I mean, there's a business side, a finance side, when you're trying to run a practice, and that's just frankly not something you're really learning in school.
So I think the same applies when you think about computer science, computer engineering, in that you go to school and you learn how the computers are working, you know, what the operating system du jour is, what the current standards are in terms of how you're designing, be it object oriented or data flow diagrams or whatever the lingo is of the day. What you really have to realize is you're not learning, while you are learning about today's technology, you're also learning about how to think about it, what the fundamentals are, and then you're getting trained in the ability to adapt and move forward as you walk through your career.
Right. It's like learning how to learn is what you're kind
learning
of doing
how to
in
learn.
School.
Yep.
Because that'll never stop on the job. You're going to have to figure out some new avenue, some way to apply those fundamentals that you picked up in school. Can you, so you had a lot of experience in technology and then in healthcare technology with your project at Philly. What was the problem you encountered that made you decide, hey, I want to start a company?
So it was really interesting as we walked through that project to see how doctors reacted to it. Every doctor, of course, probably rightly so, thinks that they are providing the best care possible for their patients. And as they were walked through some of the data that we collected, they were somewhat surprised to learn that perhaps the way they were treating patients wasn't the current standard of care. And so certainly, just like you were talking about doctors, you know, there's a lot more to being a doctor than just knowing medicine. There's a lot more to building a computer system and implementing it than the technology. So then what we had to do was we really had to learn how to work with these doctors in a non-confrontational manner in order to help them understand perhaps where some gaps in care were and how they could perhaps change their practices in order to do better. And that was just super, super interesting, rewarding. I love working with doctors. They're, you know, bright people, they learn quickly. They all want to do a better job. I mean, I have not met a doctor that didn't want to provide better care for patients where it was available. So it really instilled a love for the whole industry in my being. And then we kind of took what we learned from the diabetes model and we really applied it not only to additional diseases and states for Penn, but started working with other specialties as well. Other companies, other organizations started calling me and asking me if I could help them do the same thing for their organizations.
So I think one important thing to say on my part, I'm always kind of maybe coming at doctors a little bit, not aggressively, but with high expectations. And I should preface every interview I do and say, like, first, like, medical school is incredibly difficult. I know chemistry is a big barrier to entry there. And I was just terrible at chemistry myself. So I'm not saying I could do what all of you that have gone through medical school can do. And not only is it academically rigorous, but, you know, to get into medicine, it takes a certain kind of person, someone that, like, really wants to care for other people, someone that puts others first. And so anytime I'm critical of doctors, it's coming from a good place. I think, you know, we're all human and we're all going to have deficiencies. And, you know, when you're so focused on graduate from medical school, get through that grind, it's hard to even be aware of or think about, like, all the business concerns that will hit you like a wave once you get into, like, industry. So I just want to say that really quick. But before we keep talking about doctors, but I'm also curious, like, how you were working with doctors. Were they, are they volunteering? Were these doctors in the diabetes program, were they kind of volunteering to have, to improve their quality scores? Was it like a part of a program that they wanted to be a part of? I don't find myself particularly often inviting people to come look at my process and tell me how to do things better. So I'm just kind of curious, like how you got involved like that in that sense.
Sure. So at the time, there was a big push from the medical boards and medical specialties to work with doctors to help them understand current standards of care, current practices, because they did realize that over years, practice needs change so quickly. So the American Board of Medical Specialties had actually put in place a program where doctors had to do some sort of quality improvement program at some point during a 10-year period in order to maintain their board certification. So it was really the stick rather than the carrot that got most of them into it.
And I mean, that's kind of what I've experienced, or at least what I've seen is the standard in medicine. But, you know, there's all this great technology. I think we need to kind of embrace it. And unfortunately, the carrot method is kind of lacking when it comes to pushing that out. And even the stick has its own deficiencies too. But you know, small changes, a little bit at a time will hopefully someday lead to a bigger change in medicine. Speaking of changes in medicine, you know, coronavirus has sort of shifted a lot of our industry. Before we get to talking about that, I'm just kind of curious about like Healthmonix and the start of the company. So you had this experience, you saw a problem. Can you tell me like a little bit about when the company got started and, you know, what those early years were like?
Sure. So as I said, I kind of started by doing this individual project and didn't really have the intent to build a company. But as more and more people became interested in what I was doing, it became clear that there was a very real need for what I was doing, and to do it in a way that was as efficient and effective as possible. So that really led to, I mean, it really was a matter of folks coming to me rather than me seeking out the fact that that I wanted to do this. But like I said, it was very intriguing, great people to work with, feel like you're making a difference. It just had everything associated with it that made me want to continue and start the company up.
I got to say, I've talked to quite a few founders. That's a pretty unique story you got there. What year? When did all this happen? And how long?
2009.
Right.
Yeah. So it was probably the year before.
Same time as Dr. Chrono.
Oh, is it really? Cool.
Yeah. It's same year, 2009 was incorporated in 2009. Yeah.
So I literally started from, I was writing code upstairs in a spare bedroom. And that's how we started. And my first few employees actually came to the house until we realized, hey, this is going to be a lasting effort and maybe we should get an office somewhere.
Yeah, that's funny. Our roots are very from the ground up as well. I mean, I think Dr. Chrono's first office was right down the street from where I live in Mountain View, right across the street from Costco. And it was like, you know, maybe a 2-bedroom apartment that they were shoving 8 or 9 people into, one cook, and they were just kind of grinding, building a product. But that was 10 years ago. Can you tell me a little bit about the journey? Like, what are some of the ups and downs that you've gone through in 10 years of being a startup?
So we were really focused on these individual quality measurement and quality improvement programs. And then the government, CMS, came along and started what was called at the time the PQRS program. And that was a program where they realized that there were a lot of issues in healthcare in America. We all know that we spend the most here and we don't necessarily have the highest level of quality of care. So CMS was trying to do something about it. And one of the things that they were really invested in was to track some of these quality metrics that we at Healthmonix were already gathering. So they issued a program, PQRS, that would reward providers for turning in this data to CMS. They would actually get an incentive on all of their Medicare billing if they provided this data to the government. So at that point, our business shifted a little bit, where more and more providers were coming to us, having us help them collect this data for the purposes of the PQRS program. And then what really shifted the program into high gear was when CMS said, not only are we going to incent you if you provide this data to us, but if you don't provide it to us, there will be a penalty. And so again, carrot and stick, the carrot was nice, but the stick was stronger. So as soon as CMS said there's going to be a penalty, a 2.5% penalty on all of your reimbursement, if you don't turn this data in, our business really took off. So there were a lot of late nights. There were a lot of busy people for the first few years of the PQRS program while we adapted to the growth.
Yeah. So you were working closely with doctors that had to, start kind of paying attention to these quality of care scores and standards of care. And to my understanding, that was a pretty new idea for the industry. What was like the attitude of doctors at the time that had to start, kind of looking at these numbers?
So obviously they weren't happy about it. You and I wouldn't be happy about it either, having somebody look over your shoulder at your scores. And of course, the metrics are called into question. Are these the best metrics? So there's a lot of consternation around it. And there still to this day is. I mean, it's still a very controversial program. A lot of folks feel like it should be done away with. It's definitely imperfect, as I said the other day, but it's the best we have. And it's a starting point. And we continue to evolve and we continue to work with it. And we continue to offer CMS suggestions on how to make it better. And we will continue to do that.
I think I had a few of the same problems at university. I was not so happy with the indicators they were looking at. And if I had to share my test scores, there were some good days, but there were some bad days. So I don't know if I would be happy about it. But I think it's important to understand that, what we're trying to do here, or it's not even, it's not us, but what the government here is trying to do with their carrot and stick approaches is really try to drive like better outcomes. So you've been a part of this space for, 10 plus years. Do you think measuring these quality of care scores and, forcing doctors essentially to pay attention to them, be aware of them, and report on them, do you think it has driven improved outcomes? Has it had the kind of change that we're looking for?
So it really needs to be a culture thing. We see organizations where it really does make a difference, where the leaders are saying, hey guys, we know it's imperfect, but it does matter. And if we have patients that don't have their A1Cs in control, if we have patients that don't have their blood pressure in control, that matters. So let's start looking at this and let's start figuring out how do we work with our patients to meet these measures that CMS is putting in front of us. Now, there's a lot of issue around, is the data being collected appropriately? Is it getting attributed to the right provider? Very, very imperfect. But for those that have really embraced the culture and said, we really care about this. I mean, we have some organizations that we work with that are just delightful because they really do want to make a difference in terms of these scores. And for them, I think it does matter. But there's others that are like, I just want to get her done, check this box off, and move on to the other things in my day.
So it comes down to the attitude, essentially, is what you're saying.
Yes, absolutely.
I think that is true of organizations and of people is you can have kind of a growth mindset. What can I learn here? And if you do that, even if you're maybe like me in college, and not every class is going your way. You could still sort of try to pick some lessons out from those classes. And I do want to get into some of those lessons in a little bit. But you know, if you approach things with that growth mindset, you know, whether you succeed or fail, there's always a lesson to be learned. Versus if you don't have that approach, you can really, you know, feel like the world's out to get you when it kind of is. People are looking at your accounting. They're trying to tell you what your outcomes were, and no one likes to be told what to do. So it's an interesting challenge. I want to talk about current events and just get a sense of, you know, how you guys are doing today, given that, you know, we're living in kind of unprecedented times. Coronavirus has affected all of us. And yet, because we work in this place that's sort of in between healthcare and technology, our businesses haven't really slowed down as much as they have shifted direction, and, you know, accelerated even more than they have decelerated in some sense, when it comes to telehealth and, you know, reimbursements, that kind of thing. So I'm curious, how has COVID-19 affected your business, and what are you guys doing at Healthmonix in the face of this new reality?
Sure. So we realize that quality reporting to CMS right now isn't the main thing on these physicians' minds. You know, they're working to keep their businesses open. They're working to deal with the realities of safety. They're working on every doctor's office is in a little different position, depending on their specialty, depending on where they are, depending on whether they're in a health system or private practice. So we're trying to meet our clients where they are. Some of that is helping them understand some of the financial packages that the government has put together for doctors. Some of that is helping them understand legislative changes when it comes to some of these payment programs, these quality programs. Some of it is just listening and working with them. We're doing things like developing reopening checklists to help them understand better, you know, the collective mindset of how do we open and provide a safe environment. We're helping them understand quality in terms of telehealth as that's exploded exponentially. So we're really doing what we can to understand and listen. Like I said, I didn't get into this to make a fortune. I got into it because I wanted to really try to make a difference. And so with that mindset, we really are trying to be a partner with our clients and healthcare systems.
Yeah, that's awesome. I think it's important to understand your role. And, you know, part of what I was saying earlier about, you know, doctors in university not getting all the business sense in the world. Well, there's a lot to learn when it comes to the business side, and the rules and regulations that exist in healthcare are immense. There's red tape everywhere, and, you know, navigating that whole system is a full-time job in itself. So to ask someone, you know, to be an expert in, you know, navigating this world plus doing their other full-time job, it's too big of a ask. And you know, good on you guys for, you know, embracing your role and doing something so important in these trying times.
Well, and it's not just fulfilling their role, but it's fulfilling their role in such a changing time. I mean, oh my gosh, to be a physician right now and to deal with the uncertainties of the pandemic and everything around it is just so challenging. And then the fact that, you know, we struggle with basic things like, you know, PPE is a shame, and, you know, they're trying to run their businesses appropriately, take care of patients, and yet stay safe themselves, keep their businesses. It's an immense task.
Right. And I mean, I kind of assume that the listener knows everything that I know about medical billing and healthcare, which is to say not that much, but like, you know, these rules and regulations are changing every day. And, you know, CDC and WHO, they're adding new codes, new procedures to bill on for doctors. So it's like, how do you keep pace with, you know, not just the medical practices of the day, but then also how to bill for them? It's kind of like, you know, it's kind of hitting a tennis ball. Not only do you need to do the act of hitting the tennis ball, but there's also the follow through, which, you know, will affect the trajectory of the whole thing. So it's really complicated. And I feel for, I really do feel for doctors, because they do have to navigate this incredibly complicated and stormy landscape right now. It's crazy. Can't imagine what that's like. So in these tough, stormy times, it's important to have, you know, something solid like a compass that really navigates, helps you navigate the weather. I want to know, tell me more about like what it's like to use Healthmonix. Is it a web browser application? Does it exist on mobile? What does it feel like when it's in the doctor's hands?
So our tool is totally web-based. We're basically a software as a service, and it operates on whatever platform you happen to be using. Although I will say that if you're trying to input data on a mobile device, probably not the best, but certainly you can go in there and you can access it online through your phone, tablet, computer, whatever, and look up patient information, look up quality information, look up quality specification information. And most organizations don't enter the data in themselves. So it's great when we partner with a company such as DrChrono and the data flows in pretty automatically so that the doctor doesn't have to do anything. And what they get back out of the quality reporting tool, the Healthmonix tool, is in fact the quality data that they need to see so that they can work on improving, fulfilling any gaps in care, and or knowing that they're doing things right on.
Mm-hmm. How much setup is involved when you have like your data flowing in that way?
So again, it depends. Working with DrChrono, I like using that example since that's where we are right now. There's very, very little setup from the doctor's perspective. I think they need to go in that case and authorize it. Mm-hmm. But beyond that, I think after they do that initial authorization, the data should flow in. They do need to go in and select measures and get that started. But once that's done, then the continuing operation is pretty seamless.
When you say select measures, is that like looking, is that like determining what kind of metrics you want to look at? What do you mean by measures?
Sure. So in particular, when you're looking at the MIPS program, there are 219 different quality measures this year. And some of them apply to primary care docs, and some of them apply to radiologists, and some of them apply to oncologists and urologists, dermatologists, the whole spectrum. So you, as a healthcare provider, you go in and select which ones are most relevant to you, which ones you're going to be measured on and tracked throughout the year. So CMS has done what they can do to try to provide a broad range so that the program's relevant to all doctors.
Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out a little bit more about how that works. So there's so many quality measures, and like you said, every practice is different. You know, every practice is going to have nuance to it, and no two practices should really have the same combination of measures. Who determines what measures these practices are ultimately getting graded on that will ultimately determine, you know, the level of reimbursement?
So the
is it like a self-selected thing?
Sorry. Yeah. So the practice gets to decide. They get to say, these are the measures that I'm going to be graded on. So another interesting component of our platform, if I may, is that you can track many, many measures if you want. So let's say you go into the system and you say, oh, look, there's really 10 measures that are relevant to my practice. You can track all 10 measures throughout the year, and you can work on improvement, and you can look at your gaps in care. And then at the end of the year, you can pick your best 6 to report to CMS. So, interesting. You can sort of sway the grade you get, if you want to call it that, a little bit at the end of the year.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's pretty standard, right? I mean, even in school, there was, we'll drop the lowest homework, or, your lowest midterm score will be 50% and we'll take double your final. There was always some sort of gamesmanship to, you know, that final score. So it makes sense to me. I'm actually learning a lot about how quality measures work. That's really interesting.
That's a great analogy, but that's exactly what we're doing, is we're letting them at the end of the day pick kind of where they want their score to be coming from.
Cool. So next, I really want to get, I was really excited to talk to you to get into that engineering conversation. And I want to talk next about control systems. And so to do that, the first thing I want to do is sum up a few key concepts that I got over the course of, you know, several lower division electrical engineering courses. Like, these were big picture ideas from those classes that, you know, were sort of bigger than, you know, the day at a time stuff. And so what we were often asked to do was we'd be handed a box, and in the box there were, there was this circuitry inside. So there was wires and connections and components. And we were asked to look inside the box so that, you know, given a certain input, we could calculate the output based on that. And that's a whole mess of math and headaches that we can ignore for now. But essentially, at what you're doing is you want to know, like, given an in, what's your out? That was like a whole 2 years of lower division electrical engineering. And then in the upper division, am I right with that?
I don't know that I spent 2 years on that, but yes, that's certainly an exercise that one can do.
Sure, yeah. After the lower divs came the upper divs. And so what we did there, once we knew the input-output relationship, was we started playing with feedback. And so feedback is this idea of connecting your output back to your input in a circuit with a physical wire. And then, you know, the engineers have figured out how to twist the various knobs and adjust levels to control the feedback and in turn control the output you're getting, for whatever input you can get. It's you don't often control your input. It's sort of naturally what's coming in. So what you can control is how it travels through, and you know, you can attempt to affect the output. But why are you talking about that? I see it as a very analogous to kind of what you're doing at Healthmonix. I think, you know, we can replace that circuit, that black box, with a doctor's office and start thinking about it, an office as a control system. So did that make sense? Was I far off? Or does that sound a little bit like what you do at Healthmonix?
So we don't normally characterize it like that, but yes, one could use that analogy. So, a couple things that I will elaborate on in that regard are, number one, so certainly we provide that feedback loop to the doctor so that they can say, here are areas where I'm doing really well, so I don't necessarily need to work on the process there. And here are areas where perhaps there is room for improvement, and then we can work with them on determining what that improvement looks like. Another interesting component to that, though, as you talk about that, is the concept of the measures within quality reporting. So some of the measures are very process-oriented. It's like, so did you do this process? Did you make sure your patients all had flu shots this year? That's a very process-oriented measure. But some of the measures are very outcome measure oriented. Were your patients' A1Cs in control? So we don't measure, for example, how many of your patients got the flu. We measure the process. We don't measure how many of your patients did you give metformin to. Instead, what we do is we say how many of your patients had their A1C in control. So we do tend to look at things a little bit differently for different measures. Obviously, what we care about most is the health of the patient. So the more we can get into what that outcome is, the better off we are. But you do have to start with the process. You do have to start with, you know, what is that black box doing and how can you make that black box behave better?
Yeah, I think it's a really interesting challenge. I would argue, you know, that the electrical engineering is actually really easy when compared to, like, looking at a system like an office where, you know, instead of inputs being like voltages and currents, which are, you know, measurable very easily. It's a lot more difficult when you're dealing with people, because how do you decide like what's the right measurement that we're even going to measure, right? Like, you know, a number of flu shots actually makes a lot of sense. That's a good one, but how do you compare it to like say the outcome, the percentage of people that get flu? It's such a unique human challenge that that my brain is like, I like the structure of just circuits and wires. That stuff makes sense. But people and measuring people is much more difficult. Have you found that to be true?
So I think that the measurements are fairly easy. I think that the issue becomes, so where's the breakdown? So let's say patients are not getting flu shots. Let's say we're looking at a provider's office and we're like, geez, you know, only a quarter of the patients got flu shots. Why is that? And that's where it becomes the point about systems becomes interesting, because then you need to go into that doctor's office and figure out, why are they not getting flu shots? Does the doctor not have flu shots? In one case, they found that whatever the medication was, I think it was a flu shot that they wanted to give to the patients, needed to be refrigerated. And the refrigerator was way down at the other end of the office. And so the doctors were like, oh, it's just too big of a hassle to get the shots and to bring them over here and give them to the patients. We're just not going to do it. And so once they moved the storage of the flu shots to a place that was closer to the examining rooms, guess what? Their performance on that measure went way up. So a lot of times it's just a matter of examining. You have to get into the practice and really look at, why are things happening the way that they're happening? And it can be for a myriad of different reasons.
What you just said is really interesting. I think, you know, numbers can only tell you so much. Well, numbers will tell you a lot, but the real value for practices is sort of diving into more the why of how we got those numbers than just, you know, trying to adjust anything to make a number higher or lower.
Right. Yeah, you need to kind of do what we call a root cause analysis. Why is this number the way it is? And really kind of dive into what's happening before you can solve the problem. And then once you solve that problem, then you do kind of a cycle back. We call it a PDSA cycle, plan, do, study, act, where you say, okay, we made that change. Now let's go back and reassess and see if we fixed the problem, or if we partially fixed the problem, and where do we go from here? So it's a continuous improvement cycle, continuous improvement loop, that you really want to, in the best case, institute. But again, it's a culture thing. It's a matter of, is a practice willing to put the time in to do that sort of analysis and improvement?
And that's definitely the big question, because that sort of analysis, what's the biggest cost? It's probably time. It's probably not money. It's probably time. And just spending the time to analyze it's a big ask. It's a big cost versus like just, you know, crunching some numbers and spitting out a result and just saying, hey, we're done.
Exactly.
How do you affect that kind of change? How do you get people wanting to spend that time? Because it is such a big ask.
I think you go back to, why are they in medicine? You know, what is your goal here? And certainly we can all get caught up in the day to day, but you really need to go back to the fundamental. If you feel that this metric is important, and if you're not doing what you need to be doing on that metric, you know, you really need to dive into the cultural need of the providers to make that change.
I think that makes a lot of sense. So you work hands-on with, well, maybe not so hands-on, but, you know, you work hands-on with a lot of these doctors and bigger groups. Are there any, like, real success stories that you'd like to highlight here, of people that have used your product and, you know, done that analysis, done that PDSA loop and just had real success with it that you'd want to share and sort of, in hopes that others can sort of hear and be inspired?
So I don't, only because now that I run a company, I'm not really there. I've lost my boots on the ground kind of mentality. So unfortunately, I can't think of one off the top of my head, but I'll come back and let you know in a later time frame, Oleg.
Okay. And I'm happy to, plug that in, do some podcasting magic and get that story in there, because I'm sure they're out there. Sure. But let's talk a little bit more about the product then. I'm kind of interested. We've talked about measures, but how do you educate practices on maybe how to improve? Because we've sort of said this is a learning process. So how do you bring the learning to the practices?
So there's a variety. Again, it's a matter of where are the issues. So I think you have to start with, which is where we started way back when, the idea of quality improvement, the idea that we're doing this assessment, not just to assess, but really to find gaps in care where we can work on improvement. So there's an educational component there that needs to happen. And then once you're through that, then really focusing the group on the issue at hand. And it's not up to us to tell them where their issue is or how to solve their issue. It's really up to us to guide them through their analysis of what the problem is, because they've got the answer. I mean, that's what we've learned. It's not us that can tell them. Certainly sometimes there is a gap in knowledge. And we can provide that through continuing medical education. But most of the time, it's a process. If you get them to sit down around a table and talk about the issue, they have the answer.
So it's a matter of getting that conversation happening.
Right.
I know you guys have self-assessment tools, and we've kind of talked about them. How does that work? Are you essentially sort of, coming up with a calculation, spitting out a number, and then analyzing that? How does self-assessment work? And the difficult part, we can say again, the difficult part is always to get people wanting to do self-assessment, right? So maybe the tool is not that difficult.
Right. So, the first tool is our quality dashboard, where the providers can see a couple things. They can see their overall performance, and then they can drill down into specific patients or episodes where there might be a gap or a change that needs to happen. So getting them, first of all, to just look at the data. And we provide all that data to them through the tool. And again, at that point, a lot of times the answers become more evident. And then beyond that, we do have different self-assessment tools that we've built from time to time. It really depends on the need and the circumstance.
So having that conversation and getting people to be interested in self-assessment seems like the biggest challenge here.
Sure.
What's your kind of strategy for, encouraging doctors and providers to care about that kind of stuff?
So I'll go back to, why is CMS implementing this program? They want providers to care. And the way they're doing it is by imposing a financial incentive or penalty based on this. So that's number one. It's okay. So if we can't get doctors to really focus on this just because it's the right thing to do, what we're doing is we're trying to impose some sort of financial reward for doing it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the strategy is to sort of tie finances to outcomes. Do you think that strategy is going to work? And if it's not, is there something else? Is there something else that can be done?
So when we talk about value-based care in the U.S. Certainly the MIPS program, which is where we've invested a great deal of time, is a step in the right direction. But I think what we really need to do is more holistic programs. So when we start talking about things like accountable care organizations or capitation programs, that's where we really tie a lot of the outcomes, both in terms of cost and quality, back to what the doctors are doing. And that's when they really, really get a sense of ownership for these programs. It's a challenge, though. I mean, we've been working towards this goal for almost 20 years now, as I said before. And there's no silver bullet, and we're still working towards it.
Right. And you said step in the right direction. I think that's appropriate. And you also mentioned at the top of this interview, like, none of this stuff, none of this measurement stuff is perfect, and it changes year to year. So, you know, all we can really do is, you know, try. Well, it's like we can, it's plan, do, see, act. Is that the loop?
Study, plan, do, study, act. Yes.
Right. But it's kind of on us too, as you know, people who control quality and even, you know, CDC and people in charge of rules and regulation to, you know, look at the process that they've put in place, because it's by no means perfect, and sort of try and iterate year by year. So I think saying that MIPS is a step in the right direction is the right thing to do. So I guess I have one more tough question for you is, like, what is the next step? And is it in the same direction, or is it in a slightly different direction? I guess if you were magically put in charge of CDC, what would, or CMS, excuse me, what would your next step be?
Oh, wow. That's a loaded question. And you're right.
It's and very... forget that you're running a business. That part's not a part of it.
What would I do differently? So I think that CMS is trying to move in the right direction. I think that the biggest issue is providing these doctors with measurement tools that they feel are most appropriate. So the biggest challenge is, like I said, there's 200 and some measures out there, and it's kind of a hodgepodge, and you pick which ones you think are most appropriate. But really meeting the doctors where they are and working on quality assessment and improvement programs, I'm going to say almost on a one-off, so that it's not this big hierarchy of all your data getting rolled up and given to Big Brother. We found that as we do, when we go in and we do quality improvement programs where we meet the doctors where they are, that's the most successful. I've worked with a lot of continuing medical education folks that do that sort of practice, and doctors love it. Done right, it builds enthusiasm for quality improvement and quality measurement, and giving them a stake in what those measurements are, you know, of course, knowing. So when we go in to talk to doctors, we already have a sense of, you know, based on their specialty and based on what they do, what some key measurements are. But if we can really go in there and help them assess and help them work on improvement on a one-off basis, that's the most effective. And they really get joy out of that. They really get satisfaction out of, again, they're all in medicine because they want to provide better care for their patients. So what would I do? I would start, I would do more boots on the ground kind of quality improvement programs with individual practices and groups.
That's a really amazing answer. I think one of the patterns I've really run into here on the podcast, talking to all these different companies, is that, you know, one of the more successful strategies for dealing with healthcare professionals is to, you know, meet them halfway, or not even meet them halfway, meet them at their own place of work, their own place of business, because, you know, the job of a healthcare professional is demanding. And frankly, it's too much right now. And a result of that is doctor burnout. You see that, you know, a lot of doctors have too much pressure on them. So, you know, to have someone meet you in your place of work and come with the attitude of, you know,
trying to help and solving those problems on a human to human level versus, you know, slapping a framework over and, you know, 1,000 different practices. It seems like the right approach, and it seems like the human approach. So I think that was a really great answer.
The other thing that we can do that I think we don't focus on enough is looking at care that's being given that's unneeded. So when we talk about value-based care in the U.S., so much of the care that we give is unnecessary or ineffective. So just looking at, there's a program that the American Board of Internal Medicine, I think, was the initiator of, called Choosing Wisely, which is, as a physician, thinking about what practices, what procedures, what tests, what medications you really want to prescribe for a patient, because we spend a lot of money needlessly. And if we can at least control that sort of thing, that's also a big step in the right direction.
Yeah, I think this whole thing gets, I think it gets really confusing when there's a lot of choice involved. I'm not sure if I'm addressing exactly what you just said, but, you know, I want to address something earlier, which is that, you know, there's all these quality measures and a doctor is supposed to choose which ones pertain to their particular, their workflow. And that seems tough. And I feel like doctors in general have a good gut instinct of what quality measures make sense and which ones don't. But often, you know, it just helps to have someone, you know, check your work and just reassure you that, you know, this does make sense. This quality measure that you're looking at, it is the right one. I think that helps a lot. And I think, you know, your strategy of getting boots on the ground and helping providers out that way and just sort of reassuring them, it would be the best way to sort of improve and take that next step in the right direction.
So we have an entire staff within Healthmonix that does work with providers as they're walking through this process. So we work with them to help them choose measures if they need that guidance. We help them understand the measures. We help them understand what they're seeing on their dashboards and help them figure out how to take their next steps. So we do engage. We do provide service, because a lot of times we also find that doctors are not necessarily enthusiastic about the technology that we're putting in front of them. So helping them understand how to use that technology, which we think, I mean, our customers say to us that our UI is one of the best that they've seen. But even with that, you know, it's new to them. They're not quite sure where it's leading them. And so we do want to help them figure out how to address the needs of the program while addressing their own needs in terms of, you know, what really could potentially help me here if I'm having to participate in this quality reporting program. You know, where rather than just doing it because CMS said I have to do it, you know, is there value to me in looking at these quality metrics and understanding what they mean and where perhaps there's insights for my particular practice.
Yeah, I will take it back to my university days one more time. And I'll say, like, regardless of how great the user interface actually is, the first time you're using a new piece of software is usually the most challenging. And, you know, figuring out how to use a tool is always the great challenge, and how not to be used by the tool. You know, I just want to say thank you for putting together a great piece of technology. I think, you know, what you guys are doing and your approach is totally right. So keep doing what you're doing. Thanks for joining me on the podcast today, Lauren. It was really a fun conversation. I feel like I learned a lot in this one. So thanks for coming on.
Thanks for your time, Oleg, and thanks for the opportunity.